In the chilling grip of the Cold War, Europe faced a stark choice: band together against the looming Soviet threat or be swallowed in pieces. Against this backdrop of tension and impending doom, a warplane unlike any other was born: the Eurofighter Typhoon. It wasn't just another jet. This was Europe's answer to the Soviet Union, a direct challenge. The Eurofighter was designed to reach twice the speed of sound and could discern targets from unthinkable ranges, tantamount to detecting a lone car in New York from the edges of Philadelphia. The Eurofighter was forged to tackle, quote, any aircraft, any mission. But beneath its aerodynamic elegance and ferocious power, it brewed a tempest of political intrigue and financial calamity. The Eurofighter Typhoon project started in 1983 as the Future European Fighter Aircraft Program, or EFA. Initially, the project included the United Kingdom, Germany, France, Italy, and Spain. Three of the nations, Germany, Italy, and the UK, had finished developing the Panavia Tornado, and they wanted to produce an even more advanced jet while including additional nations in the project. The idea was for European nations to forge a unified front and combine technological expertise to maintain a competitive edge against Soviet aerial power, seen growing exponentially and posing an increasing threat to Europe each passing year. The result of the initiative had to be a multi-role combat aircraft capable of performing both air-to-air and air-to-ground missions. This adaptability was crucial to responding effectively to various threat scenarios, from intercepting Soviet bombers to striking ground targets deep within enemy territory. One of the major threats during the Cold War was the Soviet Union's formidable fleet of fast, high-altitude reconnaissance aircraft and bombers, like the MiG-25. The European fighter had to be endowed with a top-tier radar system and equipped with beyond-visual-range missiles to counter this. This would give it a distinct advantage in detecting, tracking, and engaging enemy aircraft before they could pose a direct threat. Maneuverability was another focal point in its design. To counter the Soviet Union's advanced fighter jets, like the MiG-29 and Su-27, the fighter must be designed with a delta wing configuration and canards. These features, combined with its advanced fly-by-wire control system, would allow the Typhoon to have exceptional dogfight agility, giving it an edge against most adversaries. The aircraft's avionics were ambitious in design, incorporating electronic warfare and countermeasure systems. These were vital for detecting, jamming, or deceiving potential threats from Soviet radar-guided missiles and ensuring the Typhoon's survivability in hostile environments. The Eurofighter's twin EJ-200 engines were powerful and offered an excellent thrust-to-weight ratio, ensuring that the jet could maintain high speeds and quickly climb to high altitudes, vital for interception missions and evading potential threats. Additionally, the Typhoon's design had a degree of stealth considerations, not in the same vein as dedicated stealth aircraft like the F-22 Raptor or F-35 Lightning II, but enough to reduce its radar cross-section, making it harder for Soviet-era radar systems to detect and target. The project intended to build one of the most advanced aircraft on Earth with technologies that had just barely been implemented. If the Typhoon was to be made, Europe had to stand united to absorb the tremendous strain and financial burden such a massive endeavor would entail. Amidst the alarming urgency of the Cold War, some would think that coordinating a multi-billion dollar arms project to defend their home would be streamlined. Yet, merging the ambitions and resources of some of Europe's largest nations proved to be a complex and monumental task. The confluence of national pride, economic stakes, and military strategy led to an arena where straightforward decisions became convoluted diplomatic ballets. Visionary in its scope, the aircraft was intended to possess both short takeoff and landing and beyond visual range capabilities. Yet, as with many collaborative ventures, cracks began to appear early on. By 1984, France's aspirations for a carrier-friendly version and a pivotal role led to a rift. While Italy, West Germany, and the UK decided to forge their path with the EFA program, France's definitive departure from the consortium wasn't far behind, opting instead to pursue its own domestic fighter, honed precisely to French needs, the Dassault Rafale. The hesitation and debate among European leaders was a welcome sight for the Soviet Union, whose monolithic air force continued to grow and expand its influence over the bordering nations and contested regions around Eastern Europe. Tensions were at an all-time high after France left the project in 1985, and Spain seemed to be about to do the same. Nevertheless, after a period of hesitation, it recommitted to the Eurofighter vision. Even so, financial clouds began gathering on the horizon. By 1986, costs for the project had skyrocketed to £180 million. Initial commitments of equal financial distribution became contentious, and the members of the initiative began to try to negotiate a smaller burden in the face of the growing costs. The British, who had now become the greatest supporter of the Eurofighter program, pooled government and private resources to ensure the dream didn't falter. Finally, the efforts paid off in April 1986 with the unveiling of an early prototype at BAE Wharton. This prototype, which took to the skies in August of that same year, bore the design DNA that would eventually evolve into the Eurofighter. With a clear goal and a working prototype, the commitments of each country were reevaluated and rearranged. The UK envisioned a fleet of 250, Germany 250, Italy 165, and Spain 100. The production pie was sliced according to these numbers, a strategic distribution across BAE, DASA, Air Italia, and CASA. Each nation would invest in the mega project according to how many actual fighters they sought to obtain and how soon they would get them. 1986 was also marked by the creation of the Munich-based Eurofighter Jagdflugzeug GmbH organization, vested with the massive project management task. Simultaneously, the torch of developing the engine, the EJ-200, was passed to Eurojet Turbo GmbH, an alliance of aerospace heavyweights. Initially christened as the Eurofighter EFA, the fighter transitioned to the more modern-sounding EF-2000 by 1992. Yet, harmony was short-lived. By 1990, the choice of the aircraft's radar became a flashpoint. At the heart of the debate was whether to use a mechanically scanned array or a more advanced electronically scanned array, with the latter promising better performance, but at a higher cost and developmental risk. As nations involved in the collaboration project had differing views on the direction to take, this led to significant discussions and re-evaluations. The stall lasted for several years, increasing the already sky-high budget even more and casting doubts on the feasibility of the mega project. However, recognizing the long-term benefits and the potential to keep the aircraft relevant against emerging threats, the consortium eventually agreed to develop an ASEA radar known as the Captor-E. This radar combined the advantages of electronic scanning with the existing infrastructure of the mechanical system, striking a balance between advancement and cost-effectiveness. As a result, the Eurofighter Typhoon was equipped with a radar system that significantly enhanced its operational capabilities, ensuring its competitiveness in the modern battle space. Above the landscape of Bavaria in 1994, a roar broke the morning stillness as the Eurofighter prototype took its maiden flight. DASA's chief test pilot, Peter Weger, was at the helm, known for his unflinching courage and unparalleled skills. The event led the way to a series of long and arduous trial cycles that would continue to test the capabilities of the Eurofighter even as production kicked into gear. A decade later, in the chilling cold of Vidsel Air Base, Sweden, the Eurofighter Typhoon IPA-4 was pushed to its limits. Between temperatures of minus 25 and 31 degrees Celsius, the aircraft and its systems were being verified under some harsh conditions. With the results of the different testing phases and the contrasting levels of commitment of the nations supporting the program, the Eurofighter evolved into different tiers or versions of the aircraft, Tranche 1, Tranche 2, and Tranche 3. Each tranche introduced enhancements in terms of avionics, software, and weapon systems to keep the aircraft relevant and technologically advanced. Tranche 1 was the initial version, laying the foundation for the advanced fighter's capabilities. As the program matured, Tranche 2 built on that foundation by incorporating more advanced avionics and the ability to deploy a wider array of weapons. Tranche 3, the most modern variant, further expanded the jet's capabilities with improved performance, avionics, and software, making it even more versatile and capable of handling future threats. In addition to these production tranches, there were also upgrades and capability enhancements within them, which introduced further refinements. These tweaks and modifications addressed evolving operational requirements, technological advancements, and lessons learned from active deployment. Even with the warplane already developed and in production, controversy and debate among the member nations continued. On September 2, 1998, a naming ceremony was held at Farnborough, United Kingdom. The Typhoon moniker was chosen, dredging up memories of World War II, a decision that didn't sit well with Germany due to historical scars. Rumors floated that the name Spitfire II, reminiscent of another wartime marvel, was considered but dismissed, causing further ripples in the already tense relationships between partner nations. Still, Germany and the other nations involved knew that even if they didn't agree with every aspect of the Eurofighter, the warplane was an advanced and revolutionary design, and the only jet capable of defending Europe from any threat coming from Russia or China. Four separate assembly lines churned out the Typhoon, each reflecting its nation's pride and ambition. Yet, the lines blurred as parts made by one country would be integrated into another's plane. Trust was paramount, but in short supply. Despite its initial intent to counter potential threats from the east, primarily the Soviet Union's advanced aircraft, with the Cold War's end and a rapidly changing geopolitical environment, the Typhoon's role transitioned from air superiority to a more versatile combat profile, encompassing ground attack capabilities. While the Typhoon hasn't seen as extensive combat as some of its contemporaries, it has been involved in various military engagements and operations worldwide. One of its first notable deployments was during the 2011 international intervention in Libya. As a part of Operation Elemy, the UK's contribution to NATO's Operation Unified Protector, Typhoons enforced no-fly zones and executed ground strike missions against pro-Gaddafi forces. The aircraft's precision and reliability were proven, as it successfully neutralized various strategic targets. In subsequent years, the Typhoon further solidified its combat reputation. It was deployed in the fight against ISIS as part of Operation Shader. The aircraft engaged in reconnaissance, surveillance, and direct strike roles, demonstrating its adaptability and effectiveness in asymmetric warfare against non-state actors. Besides actual combat, the Typhoon has often been scrambled for quick reaction alert duties. Especially in the airspace of northern European countries, Typhoons have frequently intercepted and shadowed Russian aircraft approaching NATO airspace. These engagements, while non-hostile, highlight the aircraft's crucial role in maintaining airspace integrity and defense against potential threats. In this regard, the Eurofighters have kept their original promise of serving as protectors of a unified Europe against the threat of Russian expansionism. The swift, versatile, and heavily armed jets effectively police the borders of Eastern Europe, keeping Russian warplanes in check and within their airspace. Moreover, its continuous upgrades and enhancements, integrating the latest in weaponry and avionics, ensures that it remains at the forefront of modern warfare capabilities. The Eurofighter Typhoon, a product of European collaboration, has grown from a Cold War sentinel to a versatile combatant in modern asymmetric warfare.